Hey, I'm Madison Taylor.
And I'm Murphy Griffin.
Welcome to episode 11 of Neophyte Boat Rights, where we're going to show you how we made the stem and the sternpost for our boat, the Newfoundland Trap Skiff. So,
let's get to it. So what are the stem and the sternpost? The stem and the sternpost are parts of the backbone of the boat. They are structural components that really start bringing the boat into three dimensions. The stem is on the fore end or the front part of the boat, and the sternpost is on the aft or back part of the boat. Now both the stem and the sternpost are accompanied by other wood pieces called knees. The stem knee and the sternpost knee are effectively big wooden brackets that hold both of those components to the keel. The stem and the sternpost have two different functions. The main use of the stem is to give a place for all the planks to terminate and attach on the front end of the boat, while the sternpost serves essentially as a big wood bracket that holds the transom to the keel. In these next couple episodes, we'll be covering everything that we had to do in order to fabricate the stem and the sternpost. Everything from lofting the two components to mounting them to the keel. So we set to lofting the stem and the sternpost. We started by establishing a grid work on the construction plan that we could use to generate our own offsets. We took all the measurements with an architect's rule and then scaled them up appropriately. So with our own offsets in hand, we could go about the lofting process just as we'd done in the past. We plotted each of the offsets, placed a nail at each of those points, and then sprung a batten across the nails. However, we found that the knees were way too curvy to use with a regular batten, so we decided to use a bandsaw blade. When lofting the stem, by far one of the most important lines that one has to determine is what's called the bearding line. Now, if you recall back in episode 5, we discussed the function of the bearding line. The bearding line shows you where the back inside edge of the planking hits the stem. To help you recall, we're providing this simple illustration where you see the profile of the stem on the left and a top-down view of the stem on the right. So you see the stem, the stem knee, and the keel. So the bearding line has to do with how the planks hit the stem. As you can see on the right in the top-down view, the planks hit the stem at an angle. And so the stem has to be beveled to accommodate the planks, as you can see on the right. The bearding line delineates the back edge of that bevel. Now, as you might have been able to guess, the placement of the bearding line on the stem is dictated directly by the angle at which the planks are hitting the stem. So the shape of the bearding line will change as the angle of the planks hitting the stem change, and this actually changes in a continuous way as we move from the base of the stem to the top of the stem. So figuring out the placement of the bearding line on the stem amounts to figuring out where the back edge of this bevel resides. Now the offsets for the bearding line are not provided in the table of offsets, so this is something that has to be determined, and it's not a trivial matter. Back in episode 6, we showed you the process to determine the forward termination points for the water lines in the half-breadth view. As long as you followed that procedure correctly, determining the bearding line is simple. In episode 6, we showed you exactly how we figured out where the water lines and the half-breadth view terminate with respect to the stem half sighting. So recall that the stem half sighting is actually a cross-section of the stem in the half-breadth view. So the plans for the Newfoundland Trap Skiff are drawn to the inside of the planking, and for that reason we had to adjust the termination points of our water lines to accommodate that fact. So once the termination points have been determined correctly, all we need to do is project them back up to the stem to determine the bearding line. So suppose we're looking at waterline 21. That's this waterline right here for our lofting. We've already determined where it terminates on the stem half sighting. So to figure out a point on our bearding line, all we need to do is take a square and line it up with that termination point. We project up to the same waterline, but in the profile view, which in this case is a grid line. So we're projecting from a curved line in the half-breadth view to the corresponding grid line in the profile view, where this projection intersects the grid line that corresponds directly to the same water line should give us a point on our bearding line. And as you can see, the blue line here, which is our bearding line, crosses through that intersection. So to determine the bearding line, all we need to do is repeat this process, this projection process, for each one of our water lines, as well as the shear. So this will generate a set of points on the interior of the stem that we then can connect with a batten. We won't actually be using the bearding line to shape the bevel on the stem until episode 12, but it's still useful to get everything hammered out now in preparation for the beveling. Okay, so it's time for us to start thinking about making the stem for the Newfoundland Trap Skiff. In order to do this, we're going to make a template first that we can then take to the lumber and trace onto the lumber and cut out. We're going to need some drafting film, some pencils, and some tape. And of course, our lofting for the stem. So to start, you take a piece of drafting film cut to an appropriate length, enough to capture the stem. And we're going to tape this down in place. And the only thing you want to be careful about as you're taping down the drafting film is that you sort of iron out the slack as you're going. So with the drafting film now taped down, we can clearly see the outline of the stem through the paper. This drafting film is really great material. It's dimensionally stable, so as the humidity and temperature changes, it doesn't warp or change or distort. And it's really sturdy. It doesn't rip very easily, so it's nice for making patterns. With the drafting film attached to the board now, we can clearly see through it so that we can trace the stem onto the paper. So one advantage of using the drafting film to transfer the lines from the lofting board to our piece of lumber is that we can pick up other important details that will help us with alignment and shaping the stem. So we're going to pick up the bearding line that we have drawn in here, as well as a couple other important lines like the shear line and some of the horizontal grid lines. Now going to adhere it to some quarter inch plywood, and this will be our pattern stock. What we're going to use is just some spray adhesive, general purpose, should do, get the job done. So once the spray adhesive has dried, we can now proceed by cutting the shape out of the quarter inch plywood with jigsaw. So it's sufficient to just do a rough cut in with the jigsaw and come back with sanders or planes and clean everything up down to the edge. And that way you just have a little bit more control of the shaping of the pattern. One important detail that's included on the stem template is the placement of the bearding line, which you see here depicted in red. So this is a very important line, and we need to transfer it onto our stem. One easy way to do this is to take a drill and drill little pinholes all along this red bearding line that we can then transfer to the stem stock using either an awl or a sharp pencil.
So just as with the stem, we needed to make templates for all the knees and for the stern post. The process is identical for all these different components.
So with the template cleaned up, we can now take it over to the piece of lumber and start thinking about how we want to orient the template on the piece of lumber to get the best grain orientation. So this is the kind of stuff that we need to consider. So we have this sawn off piece of a flitch of white oak. So looking at the end grain here, we can see a pretty common picture, which is that the grain in the middle runs almost flat, while the grain on the edges comes at a steeper angle. So the most ideal pieces of wood come from the sides here, where the grain is running almost vertical. So however we orient our template, we'd like to get as much of the stem coming from one of the two sides. Now the template has a slight sweep to it, so we can't get it perfectly all vertical. But what we're thinking is, if we orient the sweep of the stem to bend into the vertical portion, then the vast majority of the stem will be vertically grained, and just the very tips of it will traverse into the flatter grained portion of the piece of lumber. Now we're just going to trace the outline of the template onto the piece of lumber and start shaping the wood.
Let's do it. We started with a rough cut on the bandsaw, leaving room to come back with sanders and planers and shape everything by hand. We followed the standard procedure when it comes to stock preparation, jointing one of the faces first, then planing the other face so that we had parallel, flat faces. We then retraced the stem onto the stock and came back with the bandsaw and cut it out more closely. We did this so that we knew that our cuts were going to be square to the face. We now turn to a variety of sanders, orbital, belt sanders, spindle sanders, whatever was required for the particular shape. For the notch where the stem knee mates with the stem, we had to come back in with a 2-inch chisel to clean up the corner. We then followed the same exact procedure for all the knees and the stern post, tracing the shape onto the stock and cutting it out roughly at the bandsaw. Then taking it to the jointer and the planer to get two parallel flat faces. Retracing it to get an even closer cut at the bandsaw. Cutting very close to the line with the bandsaw. and then finally shaping it with a variety of sanders. So from there, it's just rinse and repeat. So we finished up the stem, stern post, and both knees, and everything was ready to get installed on the keel.
So that's episode 11. We really hope you enjoyed it. Stay tuned next time when we'll be going over the installation of the stem and the stern post onto the keel.
So if y'all are enjoying the project, don't forget to like and subscribe below, and consider becoming a patron on our Patreon. The project takes continuous funding to keep it going, and we're really counting on you to help us see it to the end.
And so on that note, we've got two new patrons. Much thanks to David Gillet
and Rob Roy.
Thanks. Bye. Bye. Esta noticia.